The need for speed is all important now. Both speed and effectiveness is super important right now. We're aware that events are unfolding very rapidly. The Pope is stepping down on Thursday, the 28th of February, because of internal divisions within the church, not because of his health. That's an excuse. Sure, his health isn't good, but what Pope's health is good as they near the end? None of them. It's because of tremendous schisms and divisions and intrigues. And this is something that we knew ahead of time would happen. And the next Pope is going to be, as prophesied, the last one, because all sorts of schisms in society are going to arise to the surface. The world is in schism. It's not just the church. The church is just a reflection of society as a whole, being that the Catholic Church is all over the planet. And the schisms within that church reflects the schisms within society. And they're very severe. And they're so bad that the Pope, for some reason, decided that he is going to wash his hands of it. It's like Pilate. I'm telling you, that this Benedict, Pope Benedict, is like Pontius Pilate, basically saying, I wash my hands of this. Do what you want to do. Basically saying to all this schismatic stuff, hey, I'm fed up. I don't want any part of this. So enough's enough. You do what you want to do. I wash my hands. That's what Pilate did. Said, look, I don't want to have anything to do with this. So then Jesus was given to the mob, and the mob said, kill him. So we're in a time now where the schisms are going to become very intense. We have a situation over in Bangladesh, the Shahbag movement, which is very interesting because I'm aware of the Shahbag area just by, you know, seems to be coincidence, because one of my great spiritual mentors lived in Shahbag area for quite a few years, actually. So I'm aware of that area, and it just happens to be this Shahbag movement is happening there. And it's a reflection of the schisms in society between atheists and religious fundamentals. Okay, huge schism. And what's happening there shows how things can get out of control and get all confusing, because basically they're using the so-called the issue of punishing the collaborators during the War of Liberation in 1971. They're using that as the emotional issue to grab everyone, but what they're really after is they're trying to get religion out of politics altogether. That's the real aim. And the people who are kind of not that interested in politics, they're getting pulled into it by saying, hey, we need to hang all these collaborators, cattle death for all the collaborators. But again, the greater purpose they're after is to remove religion from politics. So that's a huge issue, isn't it? And the schisms within the Catholic Church are trying to undermine the Catholic Church, to get it out of politics altogether. So the atheism and religious fundamentalism are two sides of one coin. They're both extremists. And those extremists are trying to pull everybody else in to the pot to get it boiling. See, they want the pot to be boiling. That's what intellectuals do. That's what revolution, the intellectuals organize revolution, always very similar. They try to use some pretext to get revolution going, pull everybody in an emotional level, and then they use the turmoil and the chaos to seize control. You see, very, very basic stuff, really. So we are seeing that in the Arab Spring, all of that kind of stuff. The revolution is in the air. The schisms are appearing, and Benedict is stepping down because he's seeing the schisms are going to rupture the church. And the Catholic Church has been going through great trials and tribulations already because of the sabotage and undermining of its authority through various scandals, etc. And apparently it's getting worse and worse and worse and worse as society begins to crumble. So society is ready to crumble. It's on the verge of crumbling. We don't realize just how bad the schisms are. In the United States, we have a severe, severe polarization, a severe schism between the political right and the political left. Both are fanatics. They're both zealots. They're two sides of one coin. And one wants to have things a certain way. Let's have religion run things. And the other says, let's get religion entirely out of it. Let's have religion have no power at all. No power in society whatsoever. So, and then those in the middle saying, well, look, we need kind of a balance. And let's not get crazy on either side. They're being pulled into the fanaticism, which is polarization, which is schism, which is collapse, which is revolution, all of that. The world is being revolutionized. And this is not a good situation for anyone. Ultimately, all of this stuff, if you want to cut through all the nonsense, which is easy to do if you just give yourself the permission to do so, is it's all an attempt to teach the ego something, all of existence. And what is the ego? It's an imaginary learner that we are imagining. There is no real ego at all. It's only our imagination. And we want to learn how to kill God, basically. Kill reality, destroy reality. We're trying to learn. Well, why would we do such a crazy thing, whimsical thing? Because we want to replace God as prime creator. And we want to be the author of reality. We, meaning spirit, not human beings, entities, out of the spirit, the Son of God wants to see on a whim, not on a malicious, out of anything malicious, but out of a sense of adventurousness and whimsicalness, saying, hey, why don't I just try this? That might be fun. So this God the Son said, let me see if I can be God the Father. Well, in order to do that, reality would have to be destroyed because God's will is fixed and reality is the way that it is. It can't be changed. So how do we get rid of God's fixed will? We'd have to kill God. That's the only way. Killing God would annihilate all of reality. So we're trying to learn how to do that. Now, we can't do it because we're one with reality. We realize God's will is fixed. We can't do it. But we say, we can. There's some other learner that can learn how to do this. It's not us. It's the ego. The ego can learn how to do this. We imagine there's a learner called the I or the ego that can learn how to kill God, destroy God. And so we're trying to teach the ego how to do this. You know, but we don't let the ego know that we're the ones teaching it. We say, oh no, all this stuff, nature, everything is happening. It's just happening. We're not doing it. And so we believe the ego's looking at all this. We tell the ego that it is God. And it is the God that created all this destructivity and death and impermanence. It's the God of existence, God of dreams. And we say, hey, God of dreams, look at your creation. Look what you're doing. And we believe that by imagining this, that somehow the learner will be real. If we just say that this imaginary learner is God, then somehow that will make it real. No, it's still not there. It's still imaginary. It's not there. It's not real. So we're trying to just deceive ourselves, really, with existence. We're trying to teach, learn something, and then we'll say, hey, we learned something. That means there must be a learner there. There has to be a learner there. But the lesson that we're trying to teach is the death of God. And that can't be learned because it can never take place. What can never take place be learned? Cannot. So it's really, if we give ourselves permission to look at this, we can look at it. All I've done is say, yeah, I'm entitled to look at this. I deserve to look at this, of course. Because God's will is fixed, and I'm one with God's will, one with reality, And I know it can't be changed, so it's totally whimsical. I wasn't created to be totally whimsical, so I have every right to look at whimsy and what whimsy is up to. What is whimsy trying to do? What is eccentricity trying to do? It's trying to teach the death of God to an imaginary learner. And praising the learner and say, oh, learner, you're God. I worship you, learner. And look at your handiwork. Look at the mountains. Look at the sky. Look at the animals. Look at the plants. Look at everything you've done. Oh my gosh, you're a mighty God. you're an awesome God. And we keep trying to pump up this imaginary learner saying, look, you're an awesome God. You can learn from all this that you've done. You've just forgotten it. You've forgotten the lesson, but you've forgotten your creation, what you created. If you just identify with your creation, you will see that you taught death. Therefore, you must be death too, you see. So we have now, you've learned death. So we imagine all this stuff, death, all these forms of death and impermanence. We imagine that there's a learner, a God that created all this, not us, but some God, a learner. And then we say, hey, God, you've forgotten about all this. Let's remind you of this. So we're going to remind you of all this death that you've created so that you will know that you created it. And you say, oh, yeah, I created all this stuff. And then we say, you see, you create like yourself. In other words, you must be death, too. You must be death, too. So you're subject to death, too. Ha ha. See, now God's will is destroyed, and now we can be prime creator. Da-da, dun-da-da-da. That's what we're trying to do here. That's all we're trying to do. So all this death, destruction stuff that we're going to imagine taking place is an attempt to teach the ego that this is what, that it learned this, it knows this, this is what it is. Ego is God. Ego is God, or ego is ego. Whatever, that it can learn how to kill God. The ego can learn how to kill. We can teach ourselves how to kill God, but we think there's some other learner other than ourselves. There's some that we think we have some other aspect of ourselves that's outside of reality that can learn how to destroy reality. And so we're having this hypothetical dream. And so we're about ready to try and teach ourselves the final lesson. Final lesson. Which is, of course, a big, big dust-up. Big dust-up. And you can see in the Shabbat movement how fast it can move. How crazy, how quickly it can get out of control. All you have to do is you have some protest movement. Then you have to have one side kill someone from the other side. Like, kill a blogger. The other side. And the police then kill a couple people from the other side who are protesting. And then you have a general strike. And then before you know it, the whole country is in chaos. And just like that, it's so ridiculous, you know. It's so easy how this happens. So we do this to ourselves. We're doing this, orchestrating it. Generate outrage. You know, we have to generate outrage. So we keep having these outrageous things happen to generate outrage. Of course, we're all doing this to ourselves. We're all orchestrating. We're the ones orchestrating all of existence. We're the ones who are dreaming all this up. We're the ones who try to who embroil ourselves in conflict and all this dreaming and conflict, dream of conflict, all in an attempt to teach the ego how to kill God. All an attempt to accomplish the impossible. There is no learner. There is no ego. There is no learner. Therefore, there is no teaching. There's nothing to learn. There's no teaching. There's no learner. There's nothing to learn. This is all a complete waste of time. Can't learn how to accomplish the impossible. However, we're going to try. We keep on trying. And we're ready to try. Make a big try. Big teaching moment. Big teaching lesson coming up. We don't need to try. We don't need to keep paying any attention to that whatsoever, actually. No, absolutely not necessary. Now, we can drop that right now easily if we give ourselves permission, but most of us won't give ourselves permission for various resistances, etc. No rational reason. It's just like, well, you know, I just feel like maybe I'm not deserving enough or something. You know, some excuse. So, what we really need to do is take a journey, take a cruise, like get on a cruise ship, take a nice, beautiful cruise, and just cool out, just cool down, and just be reminded that we deserve to drop this insane whimsy. just remind ourselves, because the whole notion that we're not deserving to drop this whimsy is itself whimsy. We're just kind of like so used to whimsy, we have a hard time not using it, not utilizing it. And there are few who make a determined effort to go over to reason instead of whimsy, and they seem to be less whimsical than others. And I see myself as someone like that, who has dedicated a lifetime to going using reason instead of whimsy. Now, to the whimsical, I probably seem incredibly whimsical, because they think that they're not whimsical. Because that's the only reference they have is eccentricity. They say, look at me and say, what in the world is going on with him? You know, he's wildly eccentric. Because look at us, we're all the same. We're not eccentric. So that's the strange dichotomy in this world. It's those who are not eccentric, those who are not given over to whimsy, will seem to be the most eccentric and whimsical in many ways, even though this is not true. So those who are still, you know, a little bit trying to groggy with whimsy need to take a nice cruise, beautiful cruise. And on that beautiful cruise, they need to remind themselves that they're entitled to drop this nonsense. Stop trying to teach the impossible. No one to teach it to. So it's totally whimsical. And on that beautiful cruise, then they'll gradually, the reminders will come, and then the entitlement, and say, hey, I'm entitled to drop this, and then the reminders will get better and better and better and better. And eventually you decide to see, you just decide to allow the vision of one to be seen, for it to see itself. Oneness sees itself. There's no outside seer seeing it. It's not like the ego sees oneness. It's not like there's an imaginary seer seeing oneness. No, oneness is seen. All of oneness. Oneness sees itself. So we can allow to accept, hey, yeah, let's just allow oneness to see itself. We're entitled to that. The way to remind oneself is through affirmation. Affirmation is simply truth reminding itself that it is true. Truth is true. It's basically saying truth is true and nothing else is true. That's all that it's saying. It's all that. But we, because of our whimsy, we need to use all these different subjects for basic affirmations to keep reminding ourselves from all these different angles, because we tend to make exclusions. We tend to say, well, okay, all this stuff over here, I'm willing to give that over to reason. But this over here, no, this whimsy still can make something of this. So let's leave that alone. That doesn't work. So what we have to do is practice including all different subjects for basically saying true, nothing else is true. This form, you know, this, whatever this is, can't accomplish the impossible. We don't need this form to try and accomplish the impossible. Instead of trying to use this form to accomplish the impossible, oneness is seen, meaning truth is true. Truth is true, and nothing else is true. So, when I talk about relocation and sidestepping the problem, sidestepping this crazy lesson that's coming up, which involves a useless, aimless waste of time, actually, it's like taking a cruise, a beautiful cruise. So what I'm doing is getting on board the cruise ship, as it were. And on board the cruise ship, there are those who will be able to assist in making the right affirmations and help keep everything smooth and be a beautiful cruise. What do you call them? The stewards, the pursers, stewards, I don't know the ship terminology. So I'm working to be one of those. And you can call it like a pilot, if you can talk about a cruise ship, piloting the ship, helping out with this whole exercise in leaving, setting futility down. Is all it's doing is setting futility down. That's all it is. And it can be a very beautiful setting of futility down. But honestly, we have to be very honest with our situation. And if we're engaged in whimsy, we can't be honest. It's very difficult. from what I see, is there needs to be this transition period of a cruise along a cruise that we kind of spend the time setting whimsy down, because the world is still quite whimsical, actually, and the people in the world are still very given over to whimsy, eccentricity, not really paying attention to reason, the voice of reason. What happens is people keep trying to substitute some reasonable form of whimsy. It doesn't work. It does not work. Reason will tell you to just do the affirmations. Just do the affirmations. So if you can't do the affirmations, you say, no, then it's whimsical. That's eccentricity. It's eccentricity. They're saying, no. We don't need to do that. We can make it work. We can find some other way that works. Some other way other than reminding ourselves that truth is true. Well, not really. We can fiddle as Rome burns, but that's not going to help at all. It's useless. So, still in this world, the world is truly enmeshed in eccentricity, whimsicality, and doesn't know how to deal with it. So, there has to be, it cannot just be a, hey, everybody, either you make it or you don't make it right now, that's it. It's too difficult. There has to be a situation where you say, well, all those who are dedicated to making it, let's take a nice, beautiful cruise, and as we're doing that, we will clean everything up, and we'll get everything shipshape, and you'll be able to make it. You'll be able to set futility down. It's very possible to set futility down, very doable. But it's also when we are engaged in a massive global lesson trying to teach the ego something at long last, it's very difficult not to get pulled into that. Very difficult not to get pulled into this situation of futility. So it's better to sidestep it. Let's say there's going to be a terrible earthquake in a city. And we live in that city. And there's a cruise ship out in the harbor. Big, beautiful, wonderful, gorgeous cruise ship. It's just got everything you can possibly want. It's so nice. And people from the cruise ship disembark to the land, and they go into the city and they start holding seminars. They say, people, there's going to be a massive earthquake very soon. 10.5 is going to destroy your city. So what we advise is for you to, let's say the city is on an island too, little island. See, we advise you to get on board the cruise ship, take a beautiful cruise, and during this cruise we will help you overcome all your traumas, your fears, your worries, all this stuff, and you won't be feeling as if your home were destroyed when this earthquake, because you will realize that this city you live in is not your home, and there is a way to get back to your home. You will realize all of this. So we're inviting you aboard this cruise ship. And so there's this outreach program to get people to go on the cruise ship. Now some people respond, they go on the cruise ship, and the cruise ship then leaves the harbor, goes away from the island, goes out to sea, and goes on its way to other beautiful, beautiful islands, gorgeous places. And of course the earthquake does happen, and the city is leveled. Tsunami comes in, finishes it off. Well, the people on the cruise ship are making right use of time, right use of mind, and they're doing affirmations. And when they hear this news, they say, okay, the destruction of a city can't teach the ego anything. The destruction of a city doesn't need to be a destruction of a city. Instead of the destruction of a city, oneness is seen. And they continue on, and they're able to get through it, no problem at all. And they are able to realize that they are entitled to set down all attempts to teach themselves something. All attempts can be set down easily. And Where does the creature finally arrive? Well, it arrives at what I say the death-free realm, the paradise realm, death-free realm, which is just such a beautiful dream and is so much like reality that we easily agree to have all dreams set down. We said we don't need dreams at all anymore, easily. And then we realize we never left reality. We've just been dreaming all this. So it's very important to listen to those who are saying, come aboard, come aboard, come aboard, come aboard. That's very important to pay attention. I'm trying to do everything I can do, and I'll keep trying to do more and more and more. I want to do more and more and more and more and more because it's not really being very effective. Is there a cruise ship? There is a cruise ship, as it were. There really is. I saw that long ago, 1978. I saw myself leaving an island that was subject, slated for disaster. And I walked out in the lagoon, and there's this huge, beautiful cruise ship. Unbelievably beautiful. Incredible. And I walked up the gangplank, walked up on board this cruise ship. And at that point, some huge bucket from a backhoe or something, huge bucket opened up near me and poured out all this gold, a whole massive pile of pure gold right where I was sitting in a chair. And I was just like, this was just radiating intense beauty and light to me. I was seeing this as in this radiant glow of all this beautiful gold. And I said, wow, that's like, it's amazing. And of course, all the people on the island were screaming at me, say, oh, don't go on the cruise ship. It's so dangerous. It's so terrible. And they're thinking that their safety is in this island, so to speak. They had it very whimsical, eccentric. But I was able to get on board. And so I know that this is the theme. This is the theme that is going forward. There is this beautiful cruise that is going to take place. We can get on board the ship. Of course, those who are staying, they're projecting their own destructivity, what they're going to undergo. They insist, no, it's not here, it's there, it's on the cruise ship. We go there, that's where the destruction is. It's not here. It's called denial and projection, which is eccentric, very eccentric. So my job is to assist in this endeavor, to help out as many as possible, to showcase what is available on the cruise ship, as it were. Now, what form this cruise ship takes, I don't know. I don't know, but it'll certainly take some form. This is a very good, model to use. Nobody has to stick around for the destructivity here in this world. Nobody, because there's nobody to learn anything. There's nobody to learn. There's no learner. We're not the learners. We're spirit. We don't need to learn anything. How can we learn anything? Reality doesn't need to be learned. We were created as one with reality. We already know reality perfectly. We don't need to learn anything. So we're not the learners. Who's the learner? There is no learner. So since there's no learner, why should we stick around trying to teach something? Teach how to kill God to some learner that doesn't exist. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. What people are saying is, if you go on that cruise ship, you'll never learn. And since you'll never learn, you'll never succeed. And since you'll never succeed, you'll be annihilated, or some nonsense like that. They're saying, oh, you're going to still be with God. Well, we're going to figure out how to annihilate God, and we're going to end up annihilating you. So that's what they're really saying. They say, don't go on that cruise ship, because if you do, you're going to be annihilated. We say, how? Well, they think that they're going to learn how to annihilate God, and then since you are still chose to be one with God, you are going to be annihilated along with God. That's what they're saying. So they're warning you of that, saying, you're making a big mistake. If they say, if you stay here, we'll go through this massive destructivity learning event, and that will teach the ego how to destroy God, and then we'll be able to destroy God, and then we will be the new prime creators, and we'll create a new reality, a new creation. So that's what their agenda purpose is. Totally whimsical. Totally. So we don't have to be that whimsical at all. We have to say, we can laugh and chuckle at it, but it's totally whimsical. Again, they're saying, don't get on board that cruise ship, because if you do, you'll be annihilated. Why do they say that? Because they believe that this huge destructivity event that's coming up on this planet will teach the ego, this non-existent learner, will teach the ego finally how to destroy God. And then once the ego learns how to destroy God, the ego will destroy God, will destroy reality, everything of reality, spirit, God, spirit, reality, destroy all of it. And then somehow the ego will be the new God, the new creator, and create a new reality. So since they believe that to be true, they believe all those who get on the cruise ship and decide to go home to God, who decide to accept God the Prime Creator as God the Prime Creator, who decide to accept reality as it is, that they will all be annihilated. So that's why they try to warn us, don't do it, don't do it, you're making a big mistake. That is why. And of course, they've got it completely nuts, backwards, it's just utter whimsy. God can't be destroyed. Going home, our home can't, is invulnerable. Our home can't be destroyed. There's no learner can ever learn how to do the impossible. So they just have it upside down and backwards. But unfortunately, we're psyched out by that. We're intimidated by it. We're frightened by it. My job is to lessen the fear. So you just say, that's just that old whimsy is playing its song, playing its violin again. Here it goes, playing the same song. You know, it's the same old song. Oh, you're going to be destroyed. You're going to be annihilated. If you go back to your home, you're going to be annihilated. We're going to figure out a way to annihilate you. So don't you do it. Stay here. We're trying to help you out. We're trying to save you. We're trying to save you. No, they're not. It's the same old song. Just same old song. Just playing the same old song. That's all it is. So you can chuckle, laugh at it. And I'm trying to bring some levity into it. Laughter. It's funny. It's sad. It's tragic. It's also funny. It's also whimsical. It's just, there you go again. Not again. There you go again. That's the gist of it. That's the gist of it. All right. Very great. That is it for this video. See you next video.